Yeah, Dave, there's some great ideas in there, and I think the idea of that moment where we set a goal that is a really motivating and directional goal, I think is really important. So we need to come back to that. But not in this moment. In this moment, I have the great honor of introducing Senator Sheldon Whitehouse. I had a chance to meet the senator a couple of years ago and hear him present and have a sense of him as being a visionary, a leader, someone who really understands the issues of healthcare reform. And he just wrote a wonderful letter to the White House that we have distributed to everyone. Everyone has it in your packet here. And when you read the letter, he makes the point that rationing care and rationing benefits is exactly the wrong direction for America. It's not where we should be going. And there are people right now who want to cut benefits and ration care and have that be the avenue to cost reduction in this country, and that's wrong. It's so wrong, it's almost criminal. It's an inept way of thinking about healthcare. And what he outlines very eloquently in the letter is what we need to do is re-engineer care, repackage care, end up with a better approach that ends up repricing care and get care right and get to where we need to be relative to cost by getting care right. And he says it incredibly well and very persuasively. And I strongly believe that it's the right direction for care. And I think it's a wonderful thing that he's here with us today. And Senator,
thank you.
Thank you.
First of all, thank you for that wonderful and indeed overly generous, even by Washington standards, introduction. And let me tell you how glad I am to be with all of you. First, because it's a reunion with Jordana Davis, who worked with me for several years when I was new to the Senate and was a great healthcare staffer. And second, because of all the work that you are doing to keep us focused in the right direction on healthcare. In addition to the faulty and inept, to use George's words, focus on rationing care rather than system improvement, the other defective view of the world that has been propagated here in Washington is that Medicare is the cost problem, and that if we just can throw seniors off the bus from Medicare, then we're going to be okay. In medical terms, that is a complete misdiagnosis of the illness, and as a result, the treatment that would be applied would be wrong and harmful, and I think ultimately would be political malpractice. When I spoke at the White House before the healthcare bill passed, when the president had a number of sessions that led up to that, I used a really prosaic example of Thelma and Louise. For those of you who remember the movie Thelma and Louise, at the end of the movie, there the two of them are, they're in that convertible, they are hurtling towards the cliff. And I use the example that we're all in that car right now, and we are hurtling towards that cliff. And the president liked that metaphor, repeated it back to the crowd when he summed up at the end of the day, so I know that he gets it. But we need to really be insistent that the task before us is to turn the direction of the vehicle that we are in, not to throw seniors off of the vehicle. And the facts really support this. The president, and it's a bipartisan consensus, the president said back in September of 2009, put simply, our healthcare problem is our deficit problem. Nothing else even comes close, nothing else. And if you want to go to the farthest side of the aisle, you can go to Congressman Ryan, whose Ryan budget puts an end to Medicare in 10 years. He says, if you want to be honest with the fiscal problem and the debt, it really is a healthcare problem. And to go to another source in government that is outside of Medicare, Secretary Gates said just the other day, I noted him saying it in the newspaper, that healthcare costs are, quote, eating the Defense Department alive. So the story that I think we need to press, which enjoys the benefit of being true, is that America's healthcare cost problem and the government's Medicare and Medicaid cost problem are the same. And the solution to it is to be found in the healthcare system and in a re-engineering, as George said, of that healthcare system. And if you focus on the right problem and bring to it the right cure, not only do you actually bring down Medicare costs, you also bring down Medicaid costs. And you bring down TRICARE costs, and you bring down VA costs, and you bring down the costs for Kaiser and Blue Cross and United and other private payers. You even bring down the cost for the self-insured, because what you're doing is bringing down the operating cost of the system rather than fighting how to allocate the costs of an exploding system. And we simply have to get about that effort, and there is every sign that if we do, it will be a productive enterprise. The American healthcare system burns 18% of our national GDP. Nobody else is close. The most inefficient country in the world at providing healthcare to its people is at around 12% of industrialized countries, 12% of GDP. We're at 18. We are 50% worse than the most inefficient country in the world. That is something that American ingenuity ought to be able to do something about. Because we're not getting 50% better outcomes for that 50% extra cost that we put into the system. In fact, we're getting crummy outcomes. We're getting outcomes that put us down in the 30s of national ranking with Greece and Croatia and countries like that. It's frankly an embarrassment to be spending as much money as we are for the results that we get. If you look at the President's own Council of Economic Advisors, they've said that you can save $700 billion a year in the American healthcare system without compromising the quality of care for anybody. And if people think, well, that's just a, you know, Democratic number trying to dodge the bullet on making the tough decisions on Medicare, no. The Lewin Group, which is a pretty conservative organization, and George Bush's, W. Bush's, Treasury Secretary, Secretary O'Neill, have both come in that the number is $1 trillion a year. So is the number $700 billion a year? Is the number $1 trillion a year? I don't know. But it is a big enough number that it is worth a really determined and sustained effort to pursue it. So I believe very strongly that there's a big goal to be reached. Now, is there a problem? Yeah, there's a very big problem. It's a problem that only matters in Washington, but we're here in Washington, so it matters. Scorability. Everybody wants to talk about how much something is going to save. We had both Rivlin and Domenici and Bowles and Simpson before my budget committee, and I pounded on them with the same question. Why not healthcare? Why are you not including this? Why are you not talking about this? The delivery system reform piece can generate these kind of savings. And the answer came back most succinctly from Alan Simpson. What you are saying, Senator, is exactly right. It is not, unfortunately, scorable. And that is why it is not in our report. So we have to have the confidence to proceed even though what we are doing is not scorable. And the reason it's not scorable isn't because it's imaginary. The reason that it's not scorable is because of the nature of the reform that is involved. I've done this before at the local level in my home state. When you take a fixed benefit and you run it through a defective system and create an impossible and unsustainable cost, something has to give. The easy math is to go after the benefit, because you can do the math on that. And if you take the system as a given, it becomes a null factor, and you can run right through to what your savings are. It is easy for the propeller heads and the economists to figure what the savings are going to be. And so all heads turn in that direction. But it is a cruel way to go about reforming a system where there is solid evidence that the delivery system part of it is defective. Why would you want to maintain a defective and inefficient system by 50% the most inefficient in the world and take that as your status quo and go attack a benefit? Why would you not instead go after the protect the benefit and work as hard as you can to fix that system? You all think about this a lot and every bit as much as I do, and you know this issue very well. And if somebody has a better analogy, I'd love to have you share it with me. But the analogy that I use is the analogy to the early days of aviation. There were the Wright brothers. They had that crummy looking kind of kite thing at Kitty Hawk. And if you stood there at Kitty Hawk with Orville and Wilbur, you could not score what was going to become of the aviation industry. It is not in its nature. It is not in innovation's nature. It is not in experimentation's nature. It is not trial and error improvement's nature to be scorable. And that's the track we're on, because it's a path of innovation. It's not mechanical. But in the same way that we can have a lot of confidence from Orville and Wilbur's experience, what was it, 80 years ago? Maybe I got the math wrong, somewhere in there, 90 years ago. Anyway, in that period of time, we went from that rickety canvas and wood and wire box, crate, whatever you want to call it, to coming sliding down a tube of electronic decision support in an aircraft that holds a population of a small town. People have served you a nice hot lunch or dinner. You've had drinks. There's a movie. You get coffee. And you land 500 or 600 people, and not one person on that plane is worried about crashing. Maybe one, but it's a condition that they have. It's not related to the safety of the enterprise. And that's kind of where we are now. And I would contend that in the same way that as aviation developed to that level of safety and expertise, the principles didn't change. The principles were a curved wing generates lift when you run air over it. A whirling propeller generates propulsion and drives you forward and creates that lift. And when you twist the end of the wings, it turns the thing. The 747 coming down at Dulles yesterday came down on those exact same principles. Curved surface over the wings generating lift. The propeller's now encased in a jet, but it's the same deal. And the wingtips and the ailerons were what we're steering. The principles were the same. The execution got better, remarkably better. And that's what I think we can do with the delivery system reform stuff. The principles are simple. You got to have a really robust electronic health record. It needs to be like a new internet for healthcare. You've got to pursue quality relentlessly and eliminate things like hospital-acquired infections that cost several billion dollars a year and should be never events. You have to identify first the areas where prevention will in fact save money and then propagate the hell out of it because it will save money. You've got to dial down the warfare between insurers and providers over getting paid, because that probably burns 20 cents out of every healthcare dollar and contributes exactly zero healthcare value. And you've got to figure out a way to reimburse doctors for value and providers for value and results and not volume and procedures. And those are the five principles that as we hone them and develop them and generate that expertise that took us from Wilbur and Orville to a Boeing 747, that we can do on delivery system reform. We have to have that confidence. We have to have that persistence. We have to recognize that we're going against the tide of the easy out, that scorability provides the benefit cut route, but it is the right thing to do because it will create enormous value across our economy, not just for the government and Medicare and Medicaid, but for employers and exporters and people who right now have, I don't know, $1,000, $2,000 worth of healthcare in their product. And it has to compete with a product that has no healthcare cost in it because it comes out of a country with a nationalized system and a VAT tax that doesn't pick up the cost. So that's where we are. I really look forward to working with you to pursue those goals. I intend to be relentless about it and would love your support, your information, your advice, your ideas. I am not the smartest person in the world on this. If you liked what I said, it's because about 150 people in the past 10 years have talked with me about this and I've assimilated it all. So I'm basically kind of a fulcrum in a big discussion, but I think it's important, and I appreciate the opportunity to share these thoughts with you. Thank you very much. If I haven't stunned everybody into silence, I'm more than happy to take a question or two if time permits, and George says time permits.
Time permits. Does someone have a question?
Yes, sir.
As you're taking the microphone back, I'd just like to reinforce that any model that we set up that involves rationing, cutting benefits, rationing care, denying care to people is the wrong model. I mean, we're spending $2.8 trillion. There is enough money. We need to just make sure the money is used in the very best ways. Question?
Yes, Senator. It's Kirk Adams from SEIU Healthcare. Over the last 2 days, we've heard over and over again this problem of scorability and the CBO. And all. It's sort of like the weather, though everybody talks about it, but no one ever does anything about it. What can we do to change the way Congress scores these things? I mean, why isn't...
Here's what I think you should do about it. I agree. Here's what I think you should do about it. Two things. First, as I indicated earlier, don't lose confidence and just keep reminding people that just because this particular scorability spotlight is on this solution doesn't make it the only solution. Just because you're an economist who needs that doesn't mean you should control this debate. The rest of us need to be heard and to remind people how and why it's important to look beyond mere scorability. The second thing, and I'll say this here because I've said it publicly and I said it to the President's legislative delegate to the Senate yesterday, and I've said it on the Senate floor, and I've said it over and over again, so I'm not speaking out of school. One of the reasons that we got a man on the moon when there was a concern about the position of America in the space race and in all the technological advancements that accrued around that space race was because the President of the United States said, in 10 years, we're going to put a man on the moon and we're going to bring him back safely. That is what we are going to do. And once that clear executive statement was made, then the whole executive bureaucracy, which was much smaller and more efficient then, wheeled into the accomplishment of that specific purpose. Compare where we are in delivery system reform. According to MIT's Gruber, we did our job on the healthcare side in the legislature. Everything we could want was in there, is his quote. You guys helped sitting down with me in the donut club every 2 weeks in the morning. Jordana would bring in the Dunkin' Donuts, and you guys and AFL-CIO and Pacific Business Council on Health and Commonwealth and CAP, and we'd all look at the bill and say, is there anything else on delivery system reform we could think to put in there? Is there anything on delivery system reform we could think to improve? And by the time that bill went through and left Health Committee, we were fine. We thought, nobody thought there was one more thing we could do. So the tools are there. The people are there. Don Burke is probably the best guy in the world for the position that he's in right now, and it is a shame and a tragedy that the Republicans have sacrificed him to being able to make the point about rationing. Mm-hmm. But that's what it is. But he's good. Sebelius gets it. She works on this every minute. Mm-hmm. The piece that is missing is that the President has never set a firm goal. And I would urge all of you to push him to set a firm goal. And by a firm goal, I mean a date and a dollar number. We will give the American people $350 billion a year in savings by January 1st of 2017. If you don't like 2017, make it 18. If you don't, whatever it is, make it something so that there is an accountability to this. If President Kennedy had looked at our space problem and said, and gave a speech that said, we are going to bend the curve of space exploration. First of all, we never would have gotten to the moon. Second of all, the speech would have been forgettable. It would have been over. You have to set goals for big institutions to achieve their purposes. Nobody knows that better than George. There is no goal. And we need to get them off of this. I've told Kathleen Sebelius that she's not allowed to speak with me on a stage and ever say the word bend the curve again. I don't know if it's going to help, but we have to get to a metric. That's what the letter was about. That's what my speeches are about. And if every single person here would get your organizations to turn to the White House and say, okay, you got the legislation you wanted. You got the best people in the world involved. You get it. Just do the last thing, the cherry on top that makes it all come real, and that is a dollar and a date deadline. That's my pitch on that, anyway. Then you can disagree with it, but at least there's a number out there. Well, thank you all very much. I don't see any further hands up, so I will leave you to your conference, but it's been a great pleasure to be with you. Let me just say one last thing. The Joint Chiefs of Staff, Admiral Mullen, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, has said that the biggest national security risk that America faces is its deficit, the debt load that we are carrying. And as you heard, everybody from President Obama to Congressman Ryan have said, if you're going to be honest about that debt and deficit, it's health care. So by the commutative principle, if that's the right principle from my old math days, our health care system is the biggest risk we face as Americans to our national security. So the work that you do to get this right, to knock 18 down to 12, to get however much we can of that $700 trillion a year, is really vital for our country and for our democracy, and I really applaud the energy that you put into it and appreciate your work very, very much. Thank you.
Thank you.